I have participated in a Torah study class this week at the Stryker Center over at Emmanuel. I've been so consumed with the urgencies, the worries, the emotional turmoil, the threats to our community in this post-October 7th world that I forgot how enjoyable it is just to study Torah with respected colleagues and reflect on our lives. That is what rabbis do in the end. So putting aside the anxiety and the anguish of our times, I want to ask you an important question for this Shabbat. Have you been following the emergence of what may be as many as a trillion cicadas throughout the Midwest and the Southeast? Do you even know what a cicada is? We have some people from overseas here that are part of the bar mitzvah family. I'll just tell you, a cicada is an ugly-looking, creepy-crawling, flying insect. It looks kind of like a grasshopper or a locust, except the North American species has this big, blood-red eyes. And one in a million cicadas have this genetic mutation that creates mesmerizing blue eyes. So once every 13 or 17 years, North American cicadas emerge from the earth in their billions. And as soon as the temperature of the earth reaches 64 degrees Fahrenheit, exactly 64 degrees Fahrenheit, on the 13th or the 17th year, depending on the species, somehow the cicadas know it's time to emerge from the earth. And this year, multiple broods are emerging together. For the first time in 221 years, two cicada broods are rising from the earth simultaneously. The last time this happened was in 1803. That was the year of the Louisiana Purchase. Thomas Jefferson was president in 1803. We are witnessing with our own eyes a once in a two century event. Now I realize that New Yorkers, they don't really feel that anything important happens unless it happens to them. And if it doesn't happen to them, it hasn't really happened. And we don't get cicadas here. And furthermore, nature for us is a weekend home near the shore or manicured parks, preferably with lots of Italian restaurants or sushi bars nearby. I walk across Central Park every day on my way to the synagogue. Even that's too much nature for me. Honestly, once I get to Le Pain Quotidien, you know, near the sheep meadow there, my anxiety dissipates. I feel my anxiety seeping out of my body. And I say, ah, civilization. Cakes, rolls, coffee near some grass and a few lilac trees. That's enough nature for me. True New Yorkers, we don't really commune with nature. We commute through nature. And we like our insects on television or online. Still, trillions of cicadas. It's a significant event. None of us will ever see it again. The next time cicadas will emerge in this quantity will be 2245. And I have some sobering news for you. At that time, I won't be your rabbi. By then, I'll be studying Torah full-time in the yeshiva shel mala, in the heavenly yeshiva, in the academy of Akiva and Moses. Maybe some of you will be there too. Wouldn't that be fun? The cicada's purpose now is to molt, mate, and multiply. They shed their outer skin, find a suitable cicada stud somewhere up on a tree, and produce the next generation of cicadas. And 4 to 6 weeks later, this generation emerging from the earth now will die, But the eggs laid by the females will drop to the earth. The baby cicadas will burrow underground, and they'll emerge again in 13 or 17 years when, I hope, I'll still be studying Torah in the Earthly Academy. The cicada invasion began because the male cicadas, having spent all those years underground, are really only looking for one thing. They climb up a tree and call out to the females with an ear-splitting, buzzing sound, masses of them, billions of them all together. Now, I've never heard a cicada song live, because we don't really do nature here in New York. But there are recordings online that you can actually go up and listen to. And for those people who live outside Manhattan, what they call nature, where they have stuff like, you know, oak trees, maple trees, pine trees, and all kinds of strange vegetation, they say that the decibel level of all these male cicadas climbing up a tree and pleading for favors from the females measures louder than a rock concert. It's actually sweet. It's a concert of love. The insect version of Woodstock in the woods. Up there on a tree, the males are pining on pine tree. The males are pining for love. In fact, scientists refer to cicadas before they actually molt as nymphs. So I want to suggest three lessons of life that we can learn from this cicadas. First, their day in the sun is fleeting. Above ground, they live for only several weeks, but their lifespan is long for an insect. They spend all those years underground. And just because we don't see them doesn't mean that they're not alive, and it doesn't mean they're not active. All these years, they're nourishing themselves underground, getting stronger, preparing for their few weeks in the sun. We don't notice because it's occurring just below the surface. And, you know, we have a tendency to value nowadays only that we see, only the surface things. We look at, you know, people of accomplishment, those who are maybe professionally or financially or personally successful, and we tend to emphasize what is before our eyes, their day in the sun. We don't really give thought to what we have not seen. All the enormous work, the years of practice and preparation that led to this success. The same is true of those who are struggling. We tend to see only that which is before us. We do not think of that which we have not seen. Prior struggles, years of hardship, disadvantage, and difficulties. Jewish tradition was clear. Our purpose in life is not necessarily to succeed, however we may define that. Success is a good thing. We believe in that in Judaism. But it's not the principal purpose of life. Nor is our destiny to fail. Failure, too, is an integral part of life. But we do not consider failure to be our permanent state. Our purpose is to work and to continue to get stronger wherever we started from in life. The sages ask, Ezehu gibor, how do we measure strength? Hakoveshet yitzro. Strength is measured by how we master our circumstances, how we make maximum use of the reality of our lives. Our purpose is to produce, and production requires perseverance, hours, days, weeks, years, and years of unseen preparation and unseen struggle. It's the work, the struggle, the perseverance that preoccupies our lives. The moments of true bliss, we step back and say, isn't life beautiful? these moments of chirping and buzzing and flying around in the sun are rare and short. We must keep going all the time, moving forward. Lo alecha amlacha ligmor, velo ata ben chorin libatel mimenu. You need not finish the tasks, say the rabbis, but neither are you free to desist from it. Second, for the cicadas, there is strength in numbers. Untold numbers of cicadas are eaten by predators, including human predators. There are all kinds of recipes online if you want to look at those recipes of frying up some cicada for yourself. But there are simply too many of them to decimate the collectivity. Most of the individuals survive because of other cicadas. Their protection is other cicadas. And so we learn that while each of our lives is precious and valuable in their own right, we must also think of others. They are our real protection. None of us can survive alone. The world is too cruel and too dangerous. We would be eaten by predators if it weren't for others who were also looking out for us. And therefore, we must also look out for them. Our strength is through others. Jewish tradition was clear. Im ein ani li mili. If I am not for myself, if I do not worry about myself, no one will worry about me. Uchshe ani la'atzmi ma'ani. But if I am only for myself, what am I? Third, the cicadas are driven to act on behalf of the next generation. What we see of them is largely about working to ensure the prosperity of posterity. So we learn that life is not only about our brief day in the sun. Even the most fortunate of us will have only a moment. How sweet is the light, and what a delight to behold the sun, wrote Ecclesiastes. When we see the cicadas and hear their trumpets, the celebration of life, and only for several weeks, we become aware of the inevitable, ineluctable passage of time. How many more cicada invasions will we see? And if we are fortunate to see the next one, we will be at a different phase in our lives. Children will have become adults. Adults will have become older adults. And many of our beloved will have passed on. Our lives are finite, and our time is limited. It is the law of life, and therefore, there's urgency for today, an urgency that redounds to the next generation. We must work also to ensure the prosperity of posterity. Nothing in life just materializes. Everything is a product of what came before. The Babylonian Talmud begins on page 2. The first page is empty, blank, symbolizing that we never begin at the beginning. Something always preceded what is. The Torah itself starts with the second letter of the Hebrew alphabet, not the first. Jewish commentators emphasize that in the beginning, Bereshit, in the beginning, does not literally mean in the beginning created out of nothing. God created many worlds before settling on this one, according to the sages. Our lives should be dedicated not only to ourselves and not only to others in society, but also to those who will come after us, those not yet born, whose names we do not yet know or might never know, but who will ensure the future and give retroactive meaning to our lives. Think of that. In 2245, our descendants will see the descendants of the cicadas of 2024. Now, isn't that an awesome thought? The Talmud records the story of a sage named Honi. One day, as he was walking on the way, he came across a man who was planting a carob tree. Honi said to the man, "How many years will it take for this plant to produce fruit?" 70 years, the man replied. "And is it so obvious to you that you will live 70 years to see the fruit of this tree that you're planting now?" The man responded, "I found carob trees in the world, just as my ancestors planted them for me, so do I plant for those who will come after me." Shabbat shalom.